Over the last several years, people have become more and more outspoken about gay rights in the U.S. But long before there was a real movement, one man went on a mission to bring injustices to homosexuals to light.
He was addressing history, he was addressing culture, he was addressing sexuality, he was addressing literature, he was addressing medical facts.
Alan Irvin Bernstein was born in Nashua in 1913. He spent his childhood in Salem, Mass., and later lived in Maine for several years. In 1940, Bernstein finished writing a 149-page manuscript titled Millions of Queers. He tried to get it published to no avail. For decades, the manuscript went unnoticed until one man rediscovered it.
It was just this shocking defense of homosexuality that this person was writing in the 1930s. And that really was unheard of.
Randall Sell is a professor at Drexel University. He happened to come across Bernstein's manuscript while doing some research at the National Library of Medicine in 2010. Sell believes Millions of Queers was among the earliest defenses of homosexuality to be written in English in the U.S.
At least for me, one of the most perplexing things about him is how did he feel so confident that he was right?
Bernstein himself was gay. In his manuscript, he wrote, "There has always been homosexuality between adults as long as there has been mankind, the same as there have always been tall men and short, fat and thin." Bernstein joined the army in 1940 during World War II, but he ended up getting a blue discharge when army officials discovered he was a homosexual. Those less than honorable discharges were given to soldiers who had, quote, undesirable habits. Bernstein talked about this during an interview he did as part of the Veteran History Project at the Library of Congress in 2003.
Sitting in the psych ward for 3 weeks while the paperwork unfolded. I could never find out what the other people were in for, but nobody else seemed to be in because being gay. I got the impression that if any serviceman got into disagreement with the superior could say, let's call him psycho and get rid of him.
Decades later, in 1981, the Army finally awarded Bernstein an honorable discharge, which he fought hard for. After his service, he went on to Harvard University, where he was pursuing his PhD. But after learning about the blue discharge, Bernstein was kicked out.
I mean, there was a period in there where he was out, and I think what that did is it put him underground. I mean, this obviously, where did it get him? Got him tossed out of the military, got him tossed out of Harvard.
Gerald Bernstein is Alan's son. He says his dad returned to New Hampshire for a short time to work as a professor.
He had taught at New England College there in Henniker.
Bernstein also taught in the Boston area and in Maine. His son says he was an activist for not only gay people, but anyone who was different. He even joined a chapter of the NAACP, and he volunteered with the Red Cross for years, even though he was barred from donating blood. Bernstein said he was upfront with his wife about his homosexuality before they got married.
Quote, I'm gay, will you marry me? Yes.
And they were married for 45 years until she died in 1991. It was not until after she passed away that Bernstein finally came out to his sons and the rest of the world. Author Alex Cates Schulman remembers that time. She and Bernstein became friends after he sold his house to her in Maine. Schulman told News 9, quote, he was in his 80s. Alan came out as gay, moving into a house with other gay men, as he described to me excitedly on one of our visits in Portland. He was philosophical in conversation, a gentleman in manner, and sweet and gentle in personality with a wry humor. So how did Gerald react when he learned that his father was gay?
Your mom, what do you do? What do you say? I suppose you can get angry or something like that. But it's still okay. I'm glad you can be you.
It was 2 years after Alan Bernstein passed away in 2008 that Randall Sell found Millions of Queers and tracked down Bernstein's sons. That was the first time they learned about their father's manuscript. Gerald says if there is one thing he'd like people to take away from his dad's writings, it's this.
Life is short. We don't need to do this to one another. We don't, let people flourish.